I'm Ross Stein, and this video is a part of the 2018 Thompson International Distinguished Lecture of the Geological Society of America. Now, the fundamental riddle of earthquakes is why, when the forces that drive the Earth's plates and every fault on the planet are absolutely steady, why under those conditions are earthquakes erratic and rare? Why do we wait several hundred years before we suddenly have an event? And the answer, my answer to that question, is contained in the QuakeCaster demo that I want to show you here. And it turns out there are four things you need to produce earthquakes, and if you have all of them, you only get earthquakes, and if you're missing any one, you never get earthquakes. So the first is the steady motion of the plate's interiors, which is represented by steadily cranking this casting reel. And that line through pulleys is attached to a rubber band. And the rubber band represents the elasticity, the rubberiness, of the Earth's crust. Believe it or not, it's rubbery, but just very stiff rubber. And they're attached to these kitchen countertop samples, which are masses with the rough sandblasted bottom surface in contact with this industrial non-skid, which is the friction on a fault. So those are the things you need, and what I want to do is show you what happens if I just crank steadily. So here we go. So you saw that the block would sit there for several hundred years and suddenly we'd have an earthquake, right? And there's nothing I can do when I call this that could create anything but earthquakes. You always get earthquakes with these four elements. Now let me ask you a question about what you just saw. Were all the earthquakes separated by the same amount of time? No! Were they all the same size if we measure size by how far they slip? No. Well, that's very bad news. Because if I can't make regular repeating earthquakes with these elements, we're never going to see them in the Earth. And we don't. We don't have regular repeating earthquakes. And that is what makes the problem of earthquake prediction so difficult. That is the bitter pill that seismologists have had to swallow in 40 years of research that shows that earthquakes do their best to be as unpredictable as possible. Okay, let's ask another question. Maybe we can't predict earthquakes, but do we have a bigger earthquake after a longer wait? It makes sense, right? Because after a longer wait, if I've been cranking at a steady rate, the spring is more taut. So maybe we get a larger earthquake afterwards. So that's the question. See what you think. Long wait, maybe moderate. Shorter wave, bigger one. Medium. Long wave, medium. No. Maybe sometimes it did, but most of the time it didn't. So that means we can't say that we're going to get a bigger earthquake if we've waited a long time since the last one. And the opposite is also true. We can't say that after a bigger earthquake, we're going to wait a longer time for the next one. As rational as both of those ideas are, they don't bear out. There's too much variability. And when you think about it, the only place that variability can be is in the friction, because the rubber band is just going back and forth, and we're cranking steadily, and it's the same mass each time. So it turns out that lowly friction controls the whole game when it comes to earthquakes. Small variations in friction, even though when I feel this on my hand, it all feels perfectly uniform to me, must control the timing and ultimately the size of earthquakes. Now let's ask another question. Right after an earthquake, is the spring loose or is it still taut? You'd think that after it moves out, the spring would get very loose, right? So let's take a look at that. So I just had a big earthquake. Look, it's still taut. It looks almost as taut as it was just before the earthquake. I'm just before, just after. So what you see here is that the spring only loses about 10 or 15% of its total tension. The stress on faults doesn't completely drop. It modulates only a small amount. And what that means is that faults spend most of their lives close to failure. In places like California and other tectonically active parts of the world, we're walking on eggshells because for the most part, all the faults are pretty much ready to go. Easily 85% of what they need to fire off, they've already got. So I've been using these two-bricker earthquakes. What happens if I have a one-bricker? So let's see what your prediction is. Do you expect that a one-bricker earthquake, if I crank at the same speed, is going to be more or less frequent? Is it going to be bigger or smaller? So let's see. We'll first do a couple of two-brickers. All right, and now I'm going to do a one-bricker. You ready? So I think here your intuition guided you right, because if we have only half the mass, the resistance is the weight of this brick times the friction coefficient, which is about 5, and therefore the resistance is half what it was before. So the spring goes earlier, and it only goes half the amount. And there are places, for example, on the San Andreas, where we have one-bricker spots compared to two. In 1906, we had an 8 in Northern California. In 1857, we had a magnitude 8 in Southern California on the San Andreas. But in between, a little town called Parkfield, we get 6s. There's our one-bricker spot. And it's interesting, everything else is the same. Same friction, same fault slip rate, 1 inch a year, 2.5 centimeters a year, but in one place, because it behaves as a one-bricker, we get these more frequent, smaller earthquakes. Okay, let's take it a step further. You can see that on one side, I have this rough sandblasted surface. On the other is that shiny, polished kitchen countertop. So what happens now if I were to flip this baby over? So now one half side of the fault has zero friction, but the other side of the fault is exactly what it was before. Now what are we going to get? So think about what you think might happen, and now I'm going to show you. Okay, here we go. So it's almost creeping, right? It's almost steady, but not quite. We're still getting earthquakes. In fact, we're getting more earthquakes than we got when it was turned over, and more than still than when we had a two-bricker. And that behavior is exactly what we see on the San Andreas between Parkfield and the San Francisco Bay Area. On a fault section about 100 or 100 miles or 150 kilometers long, called the creeping section. And lo and behold, what makes the creeping section interesting is one side of the fault has low friction, it's very slippery rock, and the other side is granite with high friction, and it behaves exactly like this. So again, friction is controlling the whole show. And if you can get the friction down very, very low, even on one side of the fault, you get this creep, which is accompanied by little pa-pa-pa-pa-pa staccato earthquakes. And that part of the fault, the creeping section of the San Andreas, has more earthquakes than any other, but they're small. So thus far, we've been dealing with a single earthquake on a fault. But most faults don't have one end-to-end rupture. They have lots of independent ruptures. So for example, the San Andreas is 1,000 kilometers long. But so far, we've only seen earthquakes of 300 kilometers length or less. So what about a fault that has a bunch of different sections? How do those interact? And that's what I'm showing you now with QuakeCaster, because I have 3 sliders in series connected by springs. So the question I want to ask you is, which one of these guys is going first? I think you're probably going to guess it's this one. Okay, who's going second? Could be this one. Could be a trick question. Who's going third? Let's just try it. So I want you to just watch what happens. So I think you could see it gets very interesting really fast. So the first one did go first, and he also went second, maybe even third. Then he took along this one, then this one went, but sometimes they all went together. And so we didn't have three independent earthquakes. We had one big earthquake because the spring was so taut between them. And that happens some of the time, but rarely. And that's exactly what we see in nature. In general, earthquakes behave independently, but sometimes the conditions are such that this guy can take his brothers with him. And for example, in 1992 in Southern California, the Landers earthquake occurred. Well, it occurred on three faults that were separated by several miles or kilometers. But what happened was the first one ruptured, and within a few seconds, the second part ruptured, and a few seconds more, the third. We ended up with a magnitude 7.3, whereas formerly, on a good day, none of those faults could produce anything larger than a 6.5. And that's what further makes earthquake prediction such a difficult target. Because we don't know if this guy is going to cascade into something big or not. And there's some chance that it occurs, but we don't know this level of tension in these springs. We only know that under some circumstances it happens, and then we have a truly large earthquake. And as far as we can tell, no little earthquake knows it's marked for future greatness. We have to wait it out. Seconds, 5 seconds to see if it's a 5, 10 seconds to see if it's a 6.5, 30 seconds to see if it's going to be over a 7. And that's just because that's how these pieces of a fault interact. Up to now, we've been thinking of earthquakes on a single fault, but we have lots of faults close together in almost every tectonically active area. So think of the San Francisco Bay Area. On the coastline, we have the San Gregorio Fault. Then we have the Major San Andreas. Then we have the Hayward Fault. Then we have the Calaveras Fault and Green Valley. So really, there are 4 or 5 major parallel faults. And earthquakes on each of those faults can affect the other. That kind of interaction we also need to capture. Think of another situation. We have a megathrust where the subduction of a plate is being shoved under a continental landmass. We have this broad surface. Those surfaces are thousands of kilometers long and hundreds of kilometers wide, and generally earthquakes are much smaller than that. And so we have earthquakes interacting on that sliding surface. So we really wanted to extend QuakeCaster from this kind of one-dimensional world to the two-dimensional world that's closer to reality, and that's why we created fishnet stocking stress. So now what I've done is I still have the casting reel reeling in this frame, but what the frame has in it is a thin elastic membrane representing the Earth's crust. That thin elastic membrane is a fishnet stocking. And what I have here is a slider. This is kind of the equivalent of the two-bricker that you saw before. And it's sitting here, and what I'm going to do is start cranking, and you're going to see how it behaves kind of like the two-bricker before. So here we go. So now what's different is you're able to see the stress buildup, not just on it, but how it spreads the stress around it. So we can see these big winds of compression. And we can see this broad area here of tension and this big area here of compression. So you can see that this guy is spreading stress out to faults on either side of it. That's what's important. All right, now let's bring in another little guy. Okay, so I'm going to back this up. And I'm going to take a little guy here. And I'm going to make that little guy rather far from the big guy. So this is about one-third or so, or a quarter of the way. And now let's see what happens. And notice that the little guy is moving 3 or 4 times for every time that this guy goes. So they're not interacting very much. It's just like what you saw with the two-brick slider versus the one-brick, where the one-brick was moving more frequently and producing smaller earthquakes. So that's fine, but what happens if I push them close together? So now I'm going to bring this little guy fairly close to the big guy. All right, they're about one fault length away from each other. Now watch. So now, while the little guy does go, typically one or two times before the big guy, when the big guy goes, the little guy always goes. What's happened is that this smaller nearby fault has become a captive. And in a sense, that's what the Hayward Fault is on the east side of the San Francisco Bay to its big sister, the San Andreas, on the west side of the bay. Because the Hayward Fault is 100 kilometers long compared to the San Andreas is 1,000, and it's slipping at about half the rate. And yet the time between big earthquakes is relatively similar between the two, because its behavior is so strongly influenced by the other. So now what I've done is taken many different sliders of different weights and put them on in almost a random manner. Think of this as a subduction zone megathrust surface, and we're asking ourselves the question, well, what are all these little earthquakes firing off? Are they all independent, or they're interacting in any kind of way? So what I want to do is just run fishnet stocking stress and for you to watch what you see here in terms of how they each throw stress. So here we go. So what you can see here is the big guy is affecting the little guy here, and remarkably, these two guys are able to communicate to each other somehow through this guy. These two in front are reacting fairly independently. They don't seem to be tied together. If you just closed your eyes and you listened to this, it would just sound like random noise. But you can see here, it's not. There are strong interactions. And if we understand how this guy has stressed this one, or how this one has stressed this one, we can do a better job of forecasting when the next earthquake would occur and where. And that's the challenge and opportunity out there, to transform that noise into signal. It's waiting for us to figure out how these earthquakes interact. And that will lead us not to earthquake prediction, but to a much better ability to forecast when and where the next earthquake will be. Thank you. I'd like to thank my collaborators on both of these demo projects. QuakeCaster was built by Kelsey Linton and myself while Kelsey was a high school student at Menlo High. When I realized what I had on my hand, I bought out all of her babysitting hours. And Jeremy Schar from Brown University built fishnet stocking stress and figured out the brilliant way in which he could non-destructively attach the sliders to the fishnet without them being drawn to each other. So thanks to these wonderful young people who've made this possible, and of course to the Geological Society of America. Instructions for how to build and teach with QuakeCaster and fishnet stocking stress are on the Templer website, Templer.net.